Yeah, pretty much like this. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the show. I'm your host, Niall Caroline, and you're watching It's About Time. Hi everyone, and welcome to It's About Time, the show where we grab someone from the past and ask them the questions we've always wanted to. Today's guest comes from the year 1985. They are the lead singer of one of the biggest rock bands in history, and they're the most likely the biggest gay icon in history, and has recently had a film made about him. Let's take a look about who we'll be interviewing today.
Freddie Mercury, one of, if not the most influential person in rock ever. The lead singer of Queen, who in themselves are one of the biggest bands in history. Freddie was notorious for his movement on stage, and the way he could get a crowd going was like no other. But it wasn't always like that for Freddie. For starters, he was born in Zanzibar, India, and spent the first 17 years of his life there until him and his family had to move due to the Zanzibar Revolution, in which thousands of Arabs and Indians were killed. He was also born with two additional incisors, which, in the end, did help as it added to his vocal range. When he moved to the UK, Freddie joined many bands after graduating, all of which unfortunately broke up or failed until he met Smile. This was Brian May's and Roger Taylor's band. Freddie joined and renamed them Queen. He designed all of their logos, and from there things took off. Queen recorded their first album, named simply Queen, and from then on they toured and brought out more albums and toured till they were selling out arenas. Freddie eventually was questioned about his personal life due to his camp essence on stage, and although he never officially came out to the world, it was made obvious by his lyrics and his presence. But to all his millions of fans, it didn't matter. They just loved him for his music and didn't care. And because of this, he helped the gay and lesbian community and became probably the biggest gay icon in history. Freddie Mercury truly was, and always will be, a legend.
Yes, that's right, everyone. Today we are going to be interviewing the one, the only, Freddie Mercury. But first, he's going to give us a performance. Ladies and gentlemen, Freddie Mercury with Someone to Love.
At the end of the day,
I take home my heart of man.
Thank you for that, Freddie. Impressive performance. Now, he'll be here in just a minute to give the interview, but first we're going to see a little bit about what was going on in the world in 1985. Over to you, Shannon.
Hello, thank you, Niall, for that. Anyway, on to the news today. We're going to be reviewing the news from 1985, which was the year Freddie came back from to be here today. The first story is that on the 1st of January in 1985, the first mobile phone call was made in the UK. Obviously, that's a very big part of history due to the revolution of mobile phones and their uses in today's society, and nowadays it's strange to think of a world without mobile phones. Secondly, is the first comic relief was in 1985 again, a very big part of history, especially in the UK, as we still do comic relief every year, and since then it has only grown bigger. Due to the amount of lives people have saved by making their donations, and the acts themselves are unimaginable, and hopefully we have made the world a better place and a happier place. The first comic relief was nothing like it is now. 150 celebrities joined together on a refugee camp for a comedy show, giving it the name Comic Relief, as it first started in comedy. The show was live streamed for millions of people around the world. Our final story is about the legendary and notorious Live Aid in 1985, where Queen Freddie Mercury's band actually performed. The live event broke many records and raised millions for people in Africa. We will now go over to Matt, who is currently there in 1985 outside Wembley Stadium, to report. Over to you, Matt.
Hello. Thank you, Alex. I'm here outside Wembley Stadium, and it is booming here. I can hear the crowd inside going absolutely wild as Queen have just come out. This has turned out to be one of the biggest Live Aids ever, and I think Queen are about to help that fact, even after joining the lineup late. I honestly just want to get inside and enjoy this legendary experience of this legendary moment of history for myself. I can hear the entire crowd inside singing along to Bohemian Rhapsody right now. I don't know if you can, but this is definitely one for the history books. Back to you, Alex.
Wow, a truly mesmerising moment that I don't think anyone will ever forget. I wish I was there to see it. Anyway, that does it for the news. Now, back to the studio now.
Thank you, Shannon. Looks like 1985 was quite a big year for the world, and I'm sure our guests will agree, as it was a big year for him as well. And speaking of, can we give a big, warm 2018 welcome to the one, the only, Freddie Mercury? Hi, Freddie. Welcome to the show. It's simply amazing to have you here.
It's great to be here. However, it's not really my kind of place.
Well, what do you mean?
This area is a bit grungy for my liking. A bit more of a fancy person myself.
Haha, we're more than aware of that, Fred.
As you should be.
Well, anyway, welcome to 2018.
Thank you. It's interesting. Not as fabulous as my time. Everyone seems to be dressed so boringly. I mean, look at your outfit.
Well, Fred, things do change.
Indeed they do, indeed they do.
Anyway, Fred, so obviously we're here to talk to you about you and your life, and as people in 18 still really love you and want to know all about it.
Well, I have no issues talking about how fabulous I am.
Well, I think they already know that, but we're going to start with where you came from. You're originally from Zanzibar in India, is that correct?
Yes, it is.
How was it moving to America? Did you find it difficult?
Well, we had to move due to the Zanzibar Revolution, which, if you know anything about, wasn't exactly pleasant. However, moving to America wasn't bad for me, as it was for some people, as I was already obsessed with Western culture, and I could now finally live in a world where that was the norm.
Well, we're all very happy that you got out of that and became what you did. And being such a fan of Western culture, how was it becoming such a big part of it?
Oh, it was a dream come true for me. There has been nothing I've wanted more into my entire life.
Obviously, on stage since joining Queen and selling out arenas, you've always been quite the performer. Have you always been such a performer?
Well, on stage, I just click. To be honest, performing comes quite easily, really. It doesn't take much for me to do so. However, when I did first start, I had some nerves, but I didn't let that stop me. I still wanted to put on a show, but when we began selling out arenas and became a headlining band, I didn't care at all, and now there's nothing holding me back.
Well, it's honestly a joy to watch and extremely entertaining.
Thank Thank you. That is all I try to do.
Well, you got a good job. Now, more into your personal life. Now, we know you don't like talking about it very much.
Well, if you mean that I'm bi, I'll say that now, because it's 2018 and it's mostly accepted. I'm sure most people have known that for a while. And all I wanted was for my music to make people happy. I don't believe that it should matter. The music is what matters.
Yeah, I think we can all agree with that. And to all of us here that are your fans, I doubt it would have mattered back then, as you most likely changed the lives of so many people with your music. You were a gay icon in today's society, as the documentary said.
Well, I was always an icon, darling.
Well, obviously. A common question I've been told to ask you is, what's your favourite song of your own or Queen's as a whole?
Well, I don't have a favourite as such. I have some that mean more to me, ones I like performing for more.
Well, what were they?
Well, my favourite to perform would probably be Radio Gaga. It's just so high energy and I just go for it and be a performer. It's also good to get a crowd going because the beat's good, it's clap along to, and of course it's such a sing-along. And personally, whenever it's on, I can't help but sing along. I bloody wrote the damn thing, but one that means the most to me is definitely Bohemian Rhapsody. It was my first song where I truly expressed the kind of music that I wanted to make, and it was something completely different that had never been done before, at least not in mainstream music. And when it did well, I was overjoyed and felt like I had truly created magic.
Well, I can tell you that you definitely did, and it's still listened to today and enjoyed to this day, and more recently, as they especially made a film about you.
Oh yes, I heard about the film. Killed it at the box office, of course. I didn't like the guy who played me, though, kind of ugly, but a good actor, I must say.
Well, anyway, I think that's all we have time for. So tell us more about concerts. You said you're quite the performer. Is there any concerts that you thought, like, beforehand, you were more nervous for than others?
Live Aid, I was just quite nervous for that, just because of the significance behind it, how it's for charity and it's a huge arena and
lots of people watching.
So many people, but I've managed to keep it hidden and keep calm enough for it to go well.
Yeah, well, as an entertainer, you need to. You said that, like, Bohemian Rhapsody was a big song for you. Did it ever get boring? Because obviously a lot of people might have only known you for that.
Kind of, in a way, yes. Because I wanted to be known as more than just the guy who wrote Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah.
However, that did change after a while, and we started releasing more songs and got a bigger presence within the genre and industry.
Yeah. So, would you say that you being gay has, like, influence your music, Joe, as you might be writing from personal experiences?
Yes, I feel so I can put in how I feel about being discriminated or having to hide my sexuality. I can put those emotions into the lyrics, and even if I don't explicitly say, oh, I'm going to have sex with a man, then I can still...
People can still relate.
People can still relate.
Yeah, so coming from nowadays, 2018, from back then, it must have been quite a shock from, like, the difference of, like, you might have had to hide it more back then than today.
Well, one person who really interested me was RuPaul, a drag queen. She has her own show. I mean, that wouldn't happen back in my day, God no.
Yeah, so... Do you think today it's more accepting than it was back then, then?
Definitely more accepting, though... Was it? Oh, sorry, I'm going to take this off.
No, feel free. It's quite warm in the studio, so...
Yes, it's definitely more accepting in today's society, though. From what I can tell, there still are some bigots and pigheads.
As there always will be, but... Do you think British culture, at least, in Britain, the majority of people are accepting of who you are and aren't discriminating against you because of it?
Yes, most definitely.
Yeah. So what was your biggest challenge growing up as gay? Do you think you knew early on, or was it more blurred?
I think it was slightly blurred, partly due to living in Zanzibar. I didn't have much representation, so I didn't really know that men could like men or women. I didn't know that it was okay to like guys. However, once I got moved to America, it was a bit more prominent, not very prominent, but at least enough to show me that actually people like me do exist and it's okay to be myself.
Yeah. Well, I think it is very important because, as you were saying, being such a prominent feature in like a lot of Western culture, it gives like a representation for gay people. When you were growing up, was that the case? Was there much representation, or was it kind of more shunned and more closed off?
I honestly can't think of any representation from back then.
Yeah, so as you were saying, in your home country, it was very, very not so as it is in Western cultures.
Yes, definitely.
So in what's your opinion of like film and TV? Like, because obviously songs like Bohemian Rhapsody have been used in many different things. Do you think that's a good thing, or do you think it takes away from the music?
Well, I heard that he didn't attempt to, that's it, try and beat me with my singing. He just lip syncs, and I'm like, I am the queen of Queen.
Yeah, obviously.
That's it.
Couldn't beat you. But
I do think it's quite good, especially this technology that we've got now.
Yeah, way more widespread, obviously, than coming back on your day. Is that, what was your opinion on the technology? Because you see the cameras around the studio, it must be quite different from back then.
It really is. It's like, although we did have cameras like this back in the 80s, they were nowhere near as fancy.
Yeah, so it must be quite a shock then, with all the people going around on mobile phones.
Absolutely. Phones weren't even handheld when I was a kid.
Long time ago. Well, anyway, I think that's all we have time for the interview, because you're going to give us another performance now, aren't you?
Yes, I'm going to do Bohemian Rhapsody.
Okay, well, if you want to go to the studio, we'll be with you in a sec. Thank you again for your time, Freddie.
Yep.
So anyway, just to keep you on the loop, Freddie is on his way to the studio now. He's going to perform one of his most legendary songs of his entire musical career, and in my opinion, possibly one of the best songs of all time. Okay, now on to Freddie Mercury with Bohemian Rhapsody in the studio, which is a very good song and has been used in many film and TV shows in the Western culture. Freddie, take it away in the studio, Bohemian Rhapsody.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy?
Better get a distinction for that.
Caught
I'm joking.
In a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy. Easy come, easy go, little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter to me. Mama just killed a man. Gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama, ooh, didn't mean to make you cry. Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango? Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo, Galileo,
Galileo, Figaro,
Magnifico.
I'm just a poor boy and nobody loves me.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah, no, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let me go!
We'll not let you go.
Let me go!
We'll not let you go.
Let me go!
Oh, mamma mia, mamma mia!
Mamma mia, let me go! Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me, for me.